In the meantime, after all these videos, camera tracking should be something very easy for you now. So in this chapter, the camera tracking part itself will be rather short, but I want to focus on something more that what you can do with the camera track. For example, there are shots like this where you might want to get rid of something. So in this case, I want to have these people gathering around maybe Big Bug Bunny, so any 3D character, and for that I would have to get rid of this guy. Even though he was doing very nice performance in Amsterdam last year, I want to get rid of him, and for that I'll have to create a clean plate. So that means I'll have to take this texture of the floor and cover him so that we don't see him. So the camera tracking part here should be very easy and straightforward, so I will very quickly do that by going to Blender, to the movie clip editor, then click on open, go to the folder with my footage, camera tracking, Amsterdam, and then load this video. Open clip, Alt A for playback. And then I will just track a few of these features. For example, these bright spots on the floor, then of course some of these windows here in the background. This one is a very good item because it is here nicely in the midground. Also, it is not on the floor, so that is good to track. This area here will be tracked so that we exactly know where he is. Of course, here in the background. So all that stuff will be tracked, but that would now be, of course, totally boring if I would explain you how to track that. I'm sure you know that. So I will do that very quickly and then we'll come back when that has finished. Alright, so that is the stuff here in the foreground on the floor, then also in the background. And now, because I really want to know where these people are standing, I'm going through the shot just to see who of these people didn't move their feet at all. And it seems that most of these people are really standing still, which is very nice, because then we can use their feet. And if they are really static, then we might even use their bodies. But I think the feet are, in this case, safer, because if they are standing on the ground and don't move their feet, then that should be really stable. So we can track that. So until here, then he moves in front of that. And after that, oh no, that is occluded. Okay, so next one. Use that, and maybe if there is someone who's really static, that guy, he doesn't move at all. It's a little bit dangerous to track people and their head, and in this case it's not really needed that badly because we have really enough tracks, but just in case, I think that he is kind of static, so we might be able to use him, although here he's leaning back. So maybe just until here. And we'll see how the error value for him is. So just in case the error value is too high, then he in fact has been moving. So then we have to delete the marker. Also, this guy seems to be quite static. But yeah, actually, I think we shouldn't do that. That is really dangerous to track people. It is probably bad. But let's see what happens. So I think these are really enough markers, and the next step I will try to solve that. So first of all, we can collapse this and this, and now let's set the keyframes. Maybe not here, because in these frames the camera is not really moving that much. So that would be not ideal to generate the perspective. And something that might be a little bit better is, I guess, here. You can turn off locked with L. So maybe something in this area. That is a nice movement from, I would say, 140 to 110 or so. So first is 110, second is 140. And then, of course, also the camera data. So again, this was my Canon 550D. Something around 20 millimeters. I have no idea, because in that case I did forget to actually note the focal length. So let's try and see what happens if we click on camera motion. And that is actually quite bad. So I press Z to go to curfew, A to look at everything, and then have a look at the jumps. So in fact here, where you also have that jump in the camera curve, there is a bit of a problem. So that was this marker. Ooh, and there was a bad jump. So that of course destroys everything. So here, Shift T to erase everything before that. Then here A again to select everything. Then also this one, that is a bad jump. So Shift T again. And now let's have a look if there's more jumps. No, that looks fine. So Shift S again. And that is a little bit better, but I suppose that we have a problem with the camera data. So that is probably not correct. So let's go ahead and activate focal length and K1, K2. Shift S. That didn't work. So maybe if I set this to 18, maybe that's better. That is the part that I really don't like about the solution, that we have to try to trigger that somehow, because that really is totally not intuitive. And but well, that's how it is currently, so we have to just try to activate the refinement, and eventually in the future that might be better. But you can already see that with 24 the solution is much better. So maybe let's go ahead and divide that, so eventually we can get a better idea of what's going on if we have a look at the 3D data. So I scroll down to the clip panel, then set up tracking scene, also set a floor plane, this one, go to reconstruction, set this as the floor, then also maybe we can orient that more, maybe here. Or let's set this as that is a good origin. So that one here near that red thing, actually it would be the center of the scene. So let's set this as the origin, then that as the x-axis, 0 to look through the camera, and that already looks quite good. But I'm not sure about the rest of the camera data. Also, I cannot see these ones, or can I? No, I can't, it's too far away. Maybe if we increase the size of the motion tracking markers. So are they somewhere? Oh, they are really far away. Oh, actually, there are some that are behind the camera, and that is always a very bad sign. So that, of course, cannot be right at all. So they have a really bad problem. And I guess that this happens because we didn't enter the distortion yet, because these are at the outside of the frame. So that would be an area with lots of distortion, and these markers obviously have quite a bit of problems. So we somehow have to try to find out the distortion. So we have to do a little bit more work until we are able to trigger the refinement. Eventually also different keyframes help. So this is something that is really annoying. Oh, but that actually helped. So now we've got our camera data here, and you can see that the distortion is very interesting. So we have a K1 value of -0.05, which is not that high, but K2 is actually quite big. So let's see what happens if we preview that by going down to the proxy, expand that, and then here at the bottom go to render undistorted. And if you look at the difference, then you can see that the center of the frame stays almost untouched. It's mostly here the borders of the frame that change. And that is the typical effect of the K2 distortion. So K1 is, well, let's say the overall distortion, but K2 mostly influences here the edges of the frame. Of course, we could also play around and see what it exactly does. So when K2 is smaller, then it would bend the edges outwards. If it gets bigger, it bends them inwards like that. So here, that should not be too large. Something like that. Of course, Control Z to go back to the previous value. So that is our camera solution, and let's have a look at that in the 3D viewport. So that looks quite reasonable. Also, these are more or less a straight line, as they should be. Maybe it's a little bit too curved, but then again, it is really here in the background, so I don't care, and it should be fine. So let's first again set the origin, also maybe a scale. So again, this is in reconstruction mode, this is the origin that defines the x-axis, and also let's just assume that this is 1 meter. So set scale, also again just to be sure, set floor, so 1 to look from the front like so. Okay, so the origin has not really worked out. Set origin like that. Set x-axis. Okay. So, also, I want to go to motion tracking and make the size much smaller again, because I don't need to see the stuff in the background. I just want to see a reasonable size here. So I think the default of 0.2 or something might be good. That looks okay. And if you playback, well, that sticks pretty well. So let's move that up. Okay, that's good enough. So let's keep this and start thinking about what we want to do. So, 0 to look through the camera, and where we've got the cube here, I want to place a character that is doing something, and the easiest way for me is to just use Big Bug Bunny, very famous animation of the Blender Foundation, because I don't have the time to model something, I'm also not very good at animating. So I just want to import something that is already finished and then place it here. So first of all, X to delete the cube. And then I want to import something from a different blend file. And importing is in this case not that kind of import, because it will be in a blend file, so we don't need any of these. But instead it will be linking. So linking means that we can link in a group from a different blend file. And that blend file I have placed here in the library folder in my tracking folder of the scene. So in lib and then rabbit rope skipping grouped.blend, that is the blend file where I want to link something from. So I can click here and go inside of this blend file, and then I've got a bunch of different folders. And if you go into group, then you will find the rabbit. So I just click on that and then link append from library. And now we've got this bunny here, And when we go to frame one, it's playing back the animation, which is nice. Maybe it would be also cool if the bunny would face the camera and not the audience. Of course, it makes sense that way, but it was, for us, it's nicer if the bunny faces the camera. So R, Z, and then we can just rotate that. And the cool thing about this linking is that it imports the animation and everything will work. And if you save the file, then the file will not be bigger as before, because everything you do is link in the data from the different blend file. So it's actually really just, well, a link. Now, there's a little problem, and that is that the rig is quite old, so it has not been created with Blender 2.6 or Blender 2.5. That is really an old rig from Blender 2.4. So some things do not really work. So for example, here there are some problems with his chin and also the chest, and especially the rope also does have a problem here. But well, that's not really a big problem. It's still funny and still nice animation. So I think it would be cool if we had this scene where the bunny is rope skipping and the audience is enjoying that. But if we wanted to composite that, then there's a little problem, and that is, of course, that we still see this guy here. Now, what we can do is to just move the bunny so that it occludes this man. But, of course, still, if the bunny jumps up, then we can still see his feet, and especially here, he moves over, so we can see him behind the bunny, and also we can see the audience. So, well, that is a little problem. And in order to fix that, we can make use of a plane. And onto this plane, we will project an image of this floor, of this stones and all that, but just without him. So we could use the GIMP or Photoshop or even Blender to paint away this guy and everything that we see here, and then just occlude that and use that as a new plane where we can also create ambient occlusion and a shadow. But let's first create a plane that can occlude this man. So we can use this one and just move it back until here, because I think that he never walks behind this area. So let's check from frame one. So his feet are there. Maybe you can go a little bit more behind so that we can have some ambient occlusion and shadow. So something like that. Then, of course, we also have to hide him in this part of the shot. So the plane should be a little bit longer, but it doesn't have to be that wide. So what we can do is to move this over here and this over there until we reach the point where he is in front of the audience. Something like that, maybe. So he's there, and then he will start moving. I think that is a little bit too close. Maybe let's move it over here. But that is now occluded, that's fine. And after that, he will still be behind the bunny. All right, so that's fine over here. So let's see if everything is fine in this part of the shot over there. So the bunny is in front of him. That can be occluded. Yeah, I think that should be fine. So an area that is really never being, well, touched by him is this. So for that, maybe we can use a loop cut, Control R, move that here. Let's use another loop cut here. And then this can be also moved like that. All right, so that is now the plane that will occlude this man. So we have a little bit of painting to do, and to be able to paint, of course, we also need to have an unwrap of this plane. And actually, for some reason, it went down the Z-axis, which should, of course, not happen. It has to be exactly here on the floor, like so. Okay, so that should now work a little bit better and should not slide, because sliding is of course the biggest problem in terms of tracking. And also, yeah, that is a little bit too long now, so that was my mistake. So that is a little bit too wide. Okay, so now that we are able to paint on that, we have to create a UV map. So, because we don't need the movie clip editor anymore, we can go here and switch that to the UV image editor. Select everything in edit mode, then press U, and then just unwrap, maybe use the smart UV project. Okay. That is now a little bit too large, so I scale it down so that it fits my UV layout. And also I make it bigger so that it can really receive a lot of texture, like that. Then new, and that will be my map. It's a stupid name, but well, it's good enough. Then let's make it 2K. I guess that 1K, so 1024 pixels should eventually be enough, but who knows. Let's just make it really large. Okay, and now we can paint on this map. But of course I don't want to paint with black or with anything else. I want to really paint an image that we see here onto this map. And in order to be able to do that, I have to create another UV map. And for that, we can go to the object data that is over here. Now we have the UV map called map. Now we can create a second one here and call that, for example, project, because that's what we are going to do now. So project, enter, and we don't even have to go to edit mode. We can just stay in object mode and go right away to the modifiers and then say add modifier and use the UV project modifier. So use that. And what the UV project modifier will do is to project the UV coordinates onto this plane from the camera. So in order to do that, we can here choose the camera, and that will then override the UV coordinates on the UV map that we can assign here. And because I don't want to destroy the smart UV project coordinates, but just want to project onto the map that is called project, I go here and say UV map project, like that. And now it will sort of override this UV map. And that's exactly what we need. So now back in the modifiers, we have to do another thing. And that is to define the pixel aspect ratio with that we project onto this plane. And because we are dealing with HD, we can use the HD pixel aspect ratio. And if you don't know what that is, then you can just calculate that here. So 1920 divided by 10, well, 80, but in this case it's 1088 because of this stupid Canon HD format thing. So 1920 divided by 1088, enter, that will give you a certain value, and that is the pixel aspect ratio for the X width of this image. So that is that. And now what are we going to project? Of course, we are projecting our footage. So now we have to go to edit mode, then make sure that we have the project active. And here I want to load the movie. So image open. Unfortunately, we cannot use the movie clip directly. We have to go to open image and then really open the footage. So here from our footage folder, I choose that, open image, then N to show the image properties. We can collapse that, we also can collapse this. But here in image, it is already set to movie as source, which is fine. But then I want to match the movie length so that we have the correct length of the movie, and also enable auto refresh so that it automatically refreshes the image of the movie here, like we have that also here. And now we should be able to see something when we enable textured viewport shading. So when I now disable the background images, then I guess we have to flip the normals. So W and then flip normals. Ah, and now we see something. Of course, that is totally distorted here. But if you look through the camera, then it makes a little bit more sense. So compared to the footage, you can at least get the idea of what's happening. Unfortunately, it is totally distorted. And the reason for that is that the UV project modifier only works on a lot of vertices or a lot of faces. So if you only have a giant plane with just four faces, then it will not work. So in order to make that work, you first have to subdivide it a couple of times. So to make that nice and even, I use another loop cut here like that, and then select everything, hit W and then subdivide. And then here in the last operator, we can increase the number of cuts and can already see that by subdividing that, it makes it more even. And with another cut, these lines now become more straight, and the more cuts you have, the better the projection will be. So now that looks pretty fine. And if you look through the camera, then that makes kind of sense. To get rid of this shading, we can go to the materials, create a new material, set it to shadeless, but still it doesn't really fit to the footage. So let's see why that happens. But if you update that, now it fits much better. So why is that? Well, currently the movie clip only updates when it is updating here in the UV image editor. So when it is updating down here, then the movie will display correctly also in the 3D viewport. Now to make that even better, I disable the undistortion and especially increase the opacity. And now it blends perfectly. So you cannot really tell that we don't see the actual footage, but just an image, unless here, of course, because it doesn't for some reason update the movie. But if you keep the UV image editor open where you see the movies that updates, then we now have a perfect blend between the movie and the projected images. Even though when you look at this in 3D, it is totally distorted and doesn't look like anything, but the only thing where you really need to see it good is from the camera perspective. So that of course looks horrible, but as soon as you rotate that more and more towards the camera perspective, then the less distortion you can see, and when you are looking from the camera, then it really looks perfect. But I mean, there is no point in projecting the same footage over the footage itself, so that doesn't make any sense. So now that we have that, we can finally start painting something, and the paint source in this case will be our movie clip that we see in the UV image editor. Okay, now I make a little bit more room here, then go to the object data, then make the map active. Now we cannot see the projection anymore, but that's not a problem. Then go to edit mode, make sure that everything is still all right. And yes, that looks fine. And because this is now active, when you start painting on it, it will be painted on this black image. And in order to be able to paint, you have to go to the paint mode. So from object mode, go to texture paint, and now we can assign a different brush, because if we would paint now, then it will just paint white color, and that is not what we want. Instead, I want to do projection painting, and for projection painting, you go to the brush and choose a different brush, and the brush that we need is the clone brush, because we want to clone something. So choose that, then scroll down here. I think we can also make the operator a little bit smaller. So go down here and maybe also set the strength to 1, and also don't need any pressure sensitivity for my tablet. Then go down to projection paint, and now we can enable clone a certain layer, and the layer that I want to clone onto this map is the project UV map. And now when I paint here, then I am in fact painting the source of the projection map layer, and that of course is the movie clip. I'm painting that here onto this plane. Now it currently fades out here, and that is because of this normal setting. For other applications, the normal influence on the painting is very clever, but in this case we don't really need that. So if I disable that and paint, then I am now painting the movie clip here onto this plane. And I can even go out of camera mode and just really quickly paint over here and thereby assign the projected layer onto this one. Like that. And of course that is pretty nice. So now even if I would disable the background images, now I can still see that footage. And the thing is that because this is now projected and I change the frame, that will now still stick to that even if I disable the background images. And that is because now, well, that is just a painted texture that is lying there on the floor and is moving together with the camera track. So that is now working very nicely. And if I enable the background images again and go to the area of the shot where he is moving in front of that, then you can see here he is gone. So in this area of the shot we have painted out him going there. So if I would disable this plane here, maybe in the outliner, there, gone, and so on. Now because of the distortion that we had, it is not quite perfect. So because the camera movement and the low angle that we are shooting here, there is a little bit of distortion. So maybe we can just blend that together. So if I go here and set the strength to 50% and now paint here very carefully, then I'm able to blend that together, because now I'm overlaying the pixels from this part of the shot, from this perspective, over the pixels that I've been applying to this texture on the first part of the shot. And there I cannot really tell any difference. I mean, if you really know that there's something going on, then you might be able to tell that this is a little bit sharper than here, but honestly, no, you can't tell it. It's just a very good effect. So that works pretty nicely, but of course here is something that we still have to get rid of. Now maybe we can do that by having a look at the background images again. So here, let's see, where is he? So in the second part of the shot he is more over here. So there, that should be something where we can just paint over. Maybe now again with 100%. So just paint that away until here. So now that is gone. And now the only thing that is problematic is here, this area. Now maybe I can go here and then paint that stuff away by using the clone brush. But before I paint, I disable the clone layer, because then you can place the 3D cursor by holding down the control key and then, for example, click here. And now you can clone from here to there, and thereby you can very easily get rid of this stuff. So control left click here to place the 3D cursor, And actually, by doing that, the cursor also goes directly onto this plane. So control left clicking in texture paint clone mode will automatically snap the cursor to that plane that you are painting on. So here, and this will now be my paint source. Paint that away. Like that. Then also, of course, here. So that will be an area that is, of course, not really that great. But then again, we've got the bunny that is in front of that. There's a little bit of movement, so that won't be really visible. Okay, let me just very quickly finish that. Yeah, it's gone. Nice. Okay, so even though the texture paint was very roughly and very poorly done, no one will notice. I mean, that is really just okay. So first of all, let's save this. So here in the map, I go to edit mode. That will automatically switch to that image that we have just painted onto this UV map. And now I save that image and then save as image. Then create a new directory, name that text or textures, and that is my floor, like that. PNG or JPEG, whatever, save as image, and then we can assign that as a texture because currently it is only assigned to the face but not yet used for this material. So in the material, I go to the textures, click on new, switch to image or movie, and then choose the map, like that. Then of course we have to set it to UV. Also of course you have to assign the correct UV map, which is map. And now we can start rendering that. Now for that of course we have to do some preparations. For example, we have to set up the render layers. So here, go to layers. Then because of the setup tracking scene button, we already have the foreground and background, but currently the background is set so that it will receive ambient occlusion and shadow. But I mean, we need that, but we also need just this shadeless image. And for that, I create a new layer. So plus sign, new layer. That will be the projection. And it would also only render this layer. But we have to do one more thing, and that is to assign an override material. Now let's have a quick look how our material is named. And well, surprise, it is only material. This is the material that is assigned to this plane. That's fine. That will be the material actually with that I want to render the projection layer, render layer. But in order to have something to receive shadows, because this is currently shadeless, I also create a new material, name that shadow, just so that I know what it is, and do nothing more than just that. I don't assign it to any face, I don't set anything here, it will just be there. And now I can go to the render layers, leave the projection just so as it is, and in background, I want to override this material with the shadow. So shadow is the override material. I also, in the projection, I want to have the vector pass so that I can create the motion blur. And now I render that. And of course that is not correct. So first let's go to the compositor. And then here we have to change something in this layout. Because currently we've got the background plate, the movie clip, and after that we are multiplying the shadow. But that's not what I want to do. And apart from that, there's quite a bit of a problem here. So, first of all, I want to have the projection render layer. So that is here, projection. And for some reason, I know what's the problem. So the problem is that for some reason that has been moved to the background layer. Of course, that is wrong. So M move to layer one, like that. Okay, that should now be better. Render again. Much better. Also, one more thing that I forgot to do, and that is to enable alpha pre-multiplied, or could also do that in layers, disable the sky, just so that we don't get any problems here in the anti-aliased edges. Okay, so we've got that. So now Shift A, filter, vector blur, apply the Z buffer and the speed, like that. And then we can alpha over that, over the footage, like that. And bam, that guy is gone. But because of the vector blur, there's a little problem here with the alpha. So that's nasty, and we have to deal with that, unfortunately. And one way to get rid of that would be to blur the edges of the whole thing so that we don't even see them. And we can do that by making, of course, use of the alpha channel, and then use the dilate erode node to make this a little bit smaller. So Shift A, go to filter, dilate erode, then try to make that a little bit smaller, like so, blur it, fast Gaussian, just a few pixels, maybe even a little bit more, like so, and then we have to apply this new alpha channel to that by going to converter and then use set alpha, like that. And now to get rid of this bright area, you can here enable convert pre-multiplied. And now the edges are gone, and we even have a little benefit from that. And that is by making the edges a little bit smaller and of course blurring them, you also get a nicer transition between footage and mask. Now, one more thing, and that is I don't want to use 100% motion blur. Just maybe 70% or so should be really enough. So that is now fixed. And after that, we can make use of the shadows to multiply them over the result of that. So here we've got the ambient occlusion and the shadow. The shadow, of course, is something that looks horrible. And of course, we could just go ahead and change the angle of the lamp, or even change the lamp type. But since this has been an overcast day, so there is no actual shadow here, at least none that I can see, so I think we can just get rid of that by not using the shadow pass at all. So just put this here and forget about the shadow pass. Like that. And now there's the bunny. In front of that, we have a nice ambient occlusion, drop shadow. Of course, we need better lighting for him, but at least that guy here is gone. So next, I want to create a little bit of better lighting by going to the 3D viewport, grabbing the lamp, and then turn it into a sun. So sun lamp, and then I think we can just turn off the shadow because there's really not much shadow in the shot. So let's just turn it off. No shadow. That would be faster to render. And then let's see how that looks like. I think we might have to increase the environment lighting a little bit so that the shadow here is not so dark. So yeah, that is a little bit too bright, I think. So let me turn that down to 0.8, and the environment lighting could be 0.3, and then render that. Okay, that's a bit too bright, but maybe we can turn that down with color curves, with RGB curves. So just turn that down. Maybe a little bit less of red. I don't know. Okay, well, that's good enough for now. So, in this part of the shot, that looks okay. But of course, when he passes in front of that, that would be later in the shot, then we will see him in front of the audience. And that is, of course, a big problem. So, for that part of the shot, we have to also mask him out. But now that we know how to do that with texture painting and projection and stuff like that, that is now totally easy. So I place my cursor here by grabbing these two markers and then hit Shift S, cursor to select it, and then Shift A, add mesh plane, RX minus 90. And then I want to make sure that the plane is really big enough to cover him in every part where he's visible. So in wireframe mode, I already see that this is probably too small. So I just grab these edges, move them out a little bit. Okay, so that's how far it should go. And then there, you can see between the bunny and this plane, we can still see his head a little bit. So that should go a little bit more over here. Also here, that should be covered like that. Okay. Okay, that's fine. Then, of course, one thing we have to do is to bring the top edge down, because if the camera is moving and you can see that the building behind the heads of the people is static, that would, of course, totally give away the illusion of masking them out. So down, so that we don't see the building behind these people. Then, and of course, it has to be high enough so that we don't see his head. So especially here, I think we might even use a loop cut for that and make this a bit higher. Okay, doesn't need to be that far. That can be a little bit lower, like this. And I think that should be fine. So now, another loop cut here, and subdivide it so that we have enough faces and enough detail for the UV project modifier to work. Also, we can go to the image editor, make that a bit smaller. Or actually, I want to go to the default setting. So default layout. And then here, U Smart UV Project, okay. Then make it smaller so that it really fits to that layout, like so. I think I could also have used the UV Project from Bounce, but it's fine. So a new image, untitled, or let me call that people. People mask, like that, okay. And now, in the object data, create a new map that will be our paint source with the movie on it. So, project. Then go to edit mode while the project is active. And then load the movie file so that we have it updating. Also, I want to make it shadeless. So, new material, that is the people mask. And it is shadeless. And of course, we have to apply the UV project modifier because that doesn't look correct. So in the modifiers, add modifier UV project, camera UV map is project, and the aspect ratio, we have to fix that because that isn't right. So 1920 divided by 1088. And now that is okay. And we can use that as a paint source. So back in the object data, I activate the UV map, then switch to texture paint. Make sure that clone brush is enabled, that you have 100% strength, and also normal disabled. And the clone source, of course, is the project UV map. So like that. Now we can just paint this quickly on top of these people. And ideally, you should do that from a frame where we don't see this man, and also maybe we don't see that bunny, like so. We can easily paint that away. And on this frame, the illusion is perfect, but if we go a few frames back, then you might see that there is a little border here. So if I now go back and forth, that is now not perfect anymore. But in this case, I think we can get away with the dilate erode and the blur node. But for now, maybe that will work. Let's see. So back in edit mode, I want to now save this image, this mask, by going to image, save as image, and then in my text folder, these are the people. All right, I've got that. Now in the material, of course, we have to apply the texture. So new texture, image, and choose the people mask, set it to the correct UV coordinates, UV, UV map. Then it should go to a new layer. So M, move to layer 3, or that layer down there. Or actually, it could have also gone to layer 2 or whatever layer, it doesn't matter. You just have to apply the correct render layer. So these are the people, and the people are on layer 11, 12, 13. Also, I want to use vector blur for them. Disable the sky or render with pre-multiplied alpha, like so. And hopefully that will now work. So render image, there's our mask. And in the composite, we can now put this on top of these people. So compositing layout, and maybe let's go in between here. So I want to just copy this whole node tree because I want to use the same thing with dilate, erode, vector blur, and set alpha. So just duplicate it with Shift D, move it up here, change the source to people. So that is now this. And with another alpha over, we can now put this in front of these people here. And it might be a little bit too blurry. So that could have been my fault. So eventually I've been painting this image while being on a blurred frame with maybe some motion blur. But still, if there is the bunny in front of it, then I don't think that it will be that obvious. Now let's see if it really works. If we go here and render on a frame where we would see him, because I guess that here the gap is a little bit too big. So eventually we might have to cheat a little bit. So let's have a look at that. Yeah, so here, especially because of the dilate, erode, and the blur, we can see him walking in front of that. So because we are blurring and dilating the mask of the ground, so we are making that smaller and blurring it. So that's why we can really see that here. So I think we just have to cheat a little bit, and that is of course not very correct. And yeah, well, but then again, it is really far away, so I don't think anyone would notice. Also, let's be really nasty and just move the feet down a little bit. So let's try again. Okay, so that now works a little bit better, although I think we can still see a little shadow from him. Yeah, so there's still something. So let me just make the dilate a little bit smaller. Also the blur could be a little bit smaller. And this is something that I could have been paying attention to in the first place, but well, that's how it goes. You do something and then just in the final frames you notice there's something going on. But I think that now fixed it. We would have to see that in motion, but I guess that it, well, it should do the trick. Okay, now, but we are replacing all these people for quite a long time, just so that we can mask him out for a rather small area and a rather short time. So in that case, we could use rotoscoping to mask out the mask. because of course we want to get rid of him, but replacing these people all the time is not really necessary. So it's just for a few frames in this little area where we really have to replace him. But since the camera is moving, we had to do this giant mask. So what we can do is to create a roto mask to mask out the mask that masks out the people. Okay, that sounds complicated, but actually it's not. So to do that, I create at any random point here, for example there, I create a curve. So Shift A, curve, Bezier circle. Rotate that so that we can see it like that. And if I now hit Z to go into solid draw mode, then we only see the outline, and that is because we still have the curve as a 3D curve. So when you create a new curve, you have to go to the curve object data and then switch from 3D to 2D. And that will make the curve appear like a solid object. And now we can animate that either by just doing very simple object animation, or we can also animate the shape. But for that, we have to enable a nice little add-on called Roto Bezier, and that will make animating this curve shape easier. So go to File, User Preferences, Add-ons, then type Roto, activate that, and then if you open up the tool shelf, then down here you can see the Roto Bezier tools. Okay, now, but to see the guy here, we have to go to wireframe mode, and then we can animate that. So first of all, here we go to edit mode, and then with G, grab everything and move it over, and then create a keyframe for that. Because here, of course, we don't really need the mask, and it is okay if it is behind the bunny. We only need to see the mask over here later. So for now, I want to create a keyframe here. So insert keyframe, and then go in 10 frame steps with shift up arrow, go forward, maybe move it a little bit like so, insert keyframe, and that will animate this mask. But of course, in these frames, it really doesn't have any effect. Only when he's moving over there, we really need it. So insert keyframe. Also here, insert keyframe, and now we can animate that. So grab this curve, move it over so that it now masks the head and the arm. So insert keyframe, and then keep on going and animate this. So G, move that over, adjust the shape, select everything, insert keyframe. And now this shape will be animated. And obviously I did a really poor job in creating these keyframes here. Don't know what happened. Ah, there seems to be a keyframe where I have been messing up the animation. So here, that should be there, of course. Select everything, insert keyframe. Move that, adjust the shape, select everything, create keyframe. And currently this is still a little bit tedious. I mean, the Roto Bezier add-on is really nice, and actually it's not that bad, but still, it allows us to mask him, and that's all we need to do. So here that can go down, insert keyframe, check if everything still works, and yes it does. And then here the animation stops. So the bunny has only been animated until frame 156 or so. So let's make this the end frame of the whole animation. So in the timeline, with my cursor here, I press E for end frame. So now the whole thing stops at frame 155. And if I press Z, then I can see this curve animating. All right, so now with that, I press M to move the mask to another layer. Maybe let's use, I don't know, maybe this one. Then of course, activate that layer so that we can see it. Also, I want to create a new mask layer. So plus sign, that is the mask for the mask mask. And that is this layer, like so. And I believe we have to do one more thing. And that is something that you will probably notice when you render that. And that is to make both of these untraceable. So the materials that we are using here for these masks can be traced by ray tracing. And that is why this object here is having an effect on the ambient occlusion on our shadow catcher. So that shadow that you can see here is caused by this plane. And also we've got a problem with our mask. So both of these should get a material that is not traceable for ray tracing and ambient occlusion. So with that selected, I go to the people mask material and then here in options, just uncheck traceable, so it will be invisible for the ray tracing that is being used to create the ambient occlusion. The same I want to do for the mask. So here, new material, mask, make it shadeless, although you don't really have to do that, but it's easier. And then also disable traceable. And if you render now again, then both of these materials won't have any effect on the ambient occlusion. So now that should be a little bit better. And now, of course, we have to make use of the mask. I mean, that's what we've made it for. So what I want to do is to limit the effect of this people overlay mask to just the area where we have created the mask. So first I press B, then move these up, Shift A at render layer, then set it to the mask mask. And the only thing that we need from the mask mask is the alpha. So connect the viewer node to the alpha so that we can see that. And now it's just a matter of dragging this inside of the alpha input or the factor input of the alpha over. And now this mask is only being applied where we have white color here in the alpha channel. Now, of course, the edge is a little bit harsh, so we can just duplicate the blur node, Shift D, drag it onto this line. And now the edges are a little bit smoother. And you can see that these blurry masked people are only here in this area, but this is now again the original footage. So before, after, before, after. And let's check on one frame where we really would see him. So that is, well, actually it is here. So let's have a look, maybe like that, F12. Eventually we have to grow the mask or shrink the blur. But no, it works quite okay. So when you look at this with our bunny, then here we've got the original footage. There we've got the static people. And it is a little bit more blurry, but not so bad that anyone would notice. And well, of course, the materials and textures of the bunny are missing, so that looks horrible. But because this tutorial is just about creating these masks and dealing with kind of clean plates, I don't really care if the bunny is pretty or not. So let's render that just to see if everything is working. So create an output directory. I've already created that. So /render/ and then set it to JPEG. And now control F12 or click on animation to animate that and see if everything works. And after rendering here in the DJV viewer, when I hit playback, then you can already see that here is something that I forgot to mask out. So that is something that some of you might have already noticed during me recording this, but well, I didn't see it. So for a final render, I would have to mask that out or just make the plane a little bit smaller. That should not be really hard to do. Just a simple Bezier curve mask that will get rid of this stuff. So that would be very easy to do, but I mean, for now, I wouldn't do it. Okay, but the rest is working really nicely. So the floor is great. We cannot see the sky. Also here, the people are moving, but still we can't see him getting in front of these people. So our little trick with the Roto Bezier mask, masking out the mask for the people, worked really great. And I think that the result is pretty good. Apart from the fact that we are missing the fur, the textures, that the rig is broken. So all these problems are, well, of course, not so nice, but not related to our tracking and compositing. And yeah, that now also concludes this little chapter on masking, projection painting, UV project, and clean plate creation.